determine the type of energy and technology they will use, as well as the price and terms of the contract. B, RPS standards also solve fuel diversity, energy security, and economic goals. You need to consider scientists 06. Renewable standards are an effective means to help meet critical fuel diversity, energy security, and economic goals. In fact, this approach has been so successful that several states, including Minnesota, Nevada, New Mexico, Pennsylvania, Texas, and most recently New Jersey, have revisited and significantly increased or accelerated their standards. C. Domestic renewable sources increase America's security, Scientific American, September 06. In addition to their environmental benefits, renewable sources promise to enhance America's energy security by reducing the country's reliance on fossil fuels from other nations. What is more, high and wildly fluctuating prices of oil and natural gas have made renewable alternatives more appealing. We are now in an era where the opportunities for renewable energy are unprecedented, making this an ideal time to advance clean power for decades to come. D. Renewable energy won't import oil and will improve the U.S. economy, Scientific American, September 06. The threat of climate change can be a rallying cry for a clean technology revolution that will strengthen the country's manufacturing base, create thousands of jobs, and alleviate our international trade deficits instead of importing foreign oil. I now start with the cross-examination. How are you today?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm good. All right. Let's talk a little bit about your case.
Okay.
At the very end, you started mentioning like a bunch of states that have increased this sort of RPS standard.
Yes.
Do you know the specific number of states that have these standards and what percentage they require of to increase for each of them?
Not specifically. I know New Mexico has a 20 by 20 plan. California has implemented one. But it's generally as the it's in the solvency A card where it tells us that this is used by the states, and actually here it says 40% of the U.S. states have adopted a U.S. electricity standard.
Okay, cool.
So, and it's different from state to state. Like, it depends on how much they've implemented it.
All right, cool. For the amount and by what year and all.
Yeah.
All right, sounds good. And so in your other card, can I see?
Yeah, you can totally, just copy these for you.
Okay, so then would you say that like Minnesota, Nevada, New Mexico, Pennsylvania, Texas, New Jersey, have they implemented this standard or are they like just studying it or
no,
what's
going
on? No,
they've implemented the standard. It's been implemented here in California and New Mexico and in these specific states, not countries.
Okay, and they're part of the 40%.
Yes.
Cool, thanks.
You can hold on to it if you want to look at
it. Okay. Yeah, might as well. Thank you.
Okay.
All right, so in your harm cards, you talk about how this funds terrorism and oppressive regimes.
Yes.
Can you just give me, like, one example of how this is, or, like, a country? What regime specifically are we funding here? This card's pretty big.
Well, the card's not so big in the sense that it's funding, like, the countries of OPEC. Like, when you see that OPEC doesn't
so
have
So all the OPEC
military.
Countries automatically have terrorism in them?
No, I wouldn't say that. I'd say terrorism is trans-borders. Like, I don't think it's specific to one country or one specific governmental system. I think that it's a problem that's epidemic in several countries.
Okay, cool. And you're saying that you cause a significant reduction in the amount of oil that we take from these other regimes, correct?
Yes.
Okay, cool. Would you say that we have to use an increase in technology to be able to move towards this RPS standard?
I'd say that the RPS standard provides for the increase of technology and development itself. Like,
okay.
Is that funny?
Yeah, thank you.
Okay. Actually, this B part is cut, so that wasn't red. That was an extension if you want.
Oh,
information.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Okay.
Yes, please. Can you hold on 30 seconds?
1:30, please.
Just gonna take a break of the water.
No, no water. No water, that's prep time. Stephanie, Stephanie.
I'm going to have two off-case positions, and I'll go on-case first. All right, first on-case, she says in observation one that we need to the federal government to help the states do this. But the fact is, this isn't a significant plan. Its insignificance is a stock issue in LD. You're going to vote her down because of that. 40% of the states have already implemented this plan, and many more are already moving towards it. So you can see that this plan isn't significant. Next on the harm, she's talking about how the majority of our oil dependence stresses our military. But however, we need to recognize and reverse this anthropocentric view. We need to start putting the environment first instead of just assuming that the environment is something that people can use. On her B point that it funds terrorism and oppressive regimes, the first point I have on this is it's really bad to assume that all OPEC and Middle Eastern nations fund terrorism and like that the oil specifically funds terrorism. But furthermore, we don't get all our oil from like the Middle East. For example, Venezuela has started to increase their production of oil significantly, and they don't fund terrorist regimes. So this is just a flawed statement overall. The next point, just in general as a broad thing over her harms, she can't solve for her harms because she isn't significant, primarily because this plan has already been implemented on another level, like they already have 40%, and secondly, because it's only a 20% increase in renewable energy in the next 14 years. That means that you're going to have a very small percentage average per year, and that's not going to be significant enough to reverse the harms that she's talking about. So on the plan, the 20% by 2020 part is another part that proves that she isn't significant. Once again, it's a stock issue, but furthermore, you can see that if she's not significant, then it significantly decreases my decide RAM, because now I can't run things about how like decreasing the dependence on foreign oil would be good, or like other dissents like this. Furthermore, she isn't able to garner her solvency or advantages if she's not significant. She's not going to be able to reverse the harms that she talks about. Next on her solvency, this is going to prove a topicality position I'm running, because she says that it's a market-driven policy to help sustain markets. She's not increasing the production, she's just increasing the use, but you'll see this in topicality. Next on her subpoint C about how renewable sources increase American security because you decrease the reliance on oil, how because it's only a small percentage increase of this renewable sources in the next 14 years, then it's not going to be significant enough to significantly decrease our dependence on foreign oil. You would have already seen a significant decrease in dependence on foreign oil, like with the 40% of the states that have this in their policy already. The next position is topicality position, and it's on produce. Produce is to give birth or rise to. This is from Merriam-Webster's Dictionary 2004. The violation is that she increases the use but not production. Specifically, you can look at her cards in her B card, which is an extension card. It says that, let me find it real quick. It says that a policy that requires electricity suppliers to gradually increase their use of renewable energy. It's not increasing production. The standards are, first of all, an effects topicality standard. If she says in her we meet that increasing the use will lead to the increase in production, it's a shift in her plan primarily, but furthermore, you can see that like it violates my ground and still violates the other standards that I'm going to be talking about, and you should still vote on that issue. I can explain it more if she does make that we meet, though. The second point is ground. If she's not producing, then it significantly decreases my ground because I don't have as many disadvantages to link. Specifically, we're supposed to be talking about production of new renewable sources, like geothermal, hydropower, these all have significant disadvantages, but I can't run them because she never increases the production of them. Next on the voters, you're going to vote on this, and it's an a priori issue, primarily because that's what the NFA-LD rule says, but I think also because it's a lot of ground abuse going on in the ground. The next position that I have is a criticism. This is called primitivism. The biggest myth about civilization is that it is merely the natural evolutionary creation of the human species. Our faith in this myth is responsible for so-called progressive reforms, such as the affirmative, that attempt to solve environmental harms through the civilized apparatuses that make them possible. We need to look towards new primitive directions for interacting with Earth, Heinberg 95. We in the industrial world have gradually accustomed ourselves to a way of life that appears to be leading toward a universal biological holocaust. The question is, shall we choose to live shall we choose to gradually accustom ourselves to another way of life, one that successfully integrates human purposes with ecological imperatives, or shall we cling to our present choices to the bitter end? The next point is the link. Modern civilization is responsible for ecological devastation and the manipulation of the human spirit. This is also with technology, and in cross-examination, I linked her to this position. Heinberg 95. By most estimates, oceans are dying, and the human population is expanding far beyond long-term carrying capacity of the land. The ozone layer is disappearing, and the global climate is showing worrisome signs of instability. Unless drastic steps are taken, in 50 years, the vast majority of the world's population will likely be existing in conditions such that the lifestyle of virtually any undisturbed primitive tribe would be paradise by comparison. And the next point is the impacts. The first one is that if technology continues to develop, it will lead to major suffering and destroy the individual in favor of the all-powerful industrial machine, from New York Times 95. Furthermore, if the system survives, the consequences will be inevitable. There is no way of reforming or modifying the system so as to prevent it from depriving people of dignity and autonomy. Next, impact. Civilization maintains a utilitarian grip upon the environment by separating humanity from the larger natural context. Primitivism offers the inverse of this destructive relationship. Heinberg 95. Civilized people are accustomed to an anthropocentric view of the world. Our interest in the environment is utilitarian. It is of value because it is of use or potential use to human beings. Primitive peoples, in contrast, tend to see nature as intrinsically meaningful. The alternative. We need to revolt against this exploitative system and move towards living in small communities with a sustainable approach. From New York Times 95. In the third place, it is not at all certain that the survival of the system will lead to less suffering than the breakdown of the system would. The system has already caused and is continuing to cause immense suffering all over the world. Ancient cultures that for hundreds of years gave people a satisfactory relationship with each other and their environment have been shattered by contact with industrial society, and the result has been a whole catalog of economic, environmental, social, and psychological problems. The next card is that small communities are essential to fix this problem and anthropocentric. This is from greenanarchy.org. I began to fully realize the importance of interpersonal and interpolitical relationship skills as absolutely crucial survival skills within the primitive life way. Humans evolved to be communal beings, much like wolves, and a lone individual living off the land will have a very difficult time compared to a tightly knit group that can flow well together to get things done. Traditional indigenous peoples devote a great deal of their cultural energy to this process, much more than to material culture, with considerable success. The next point, and the reason why you're going to prefer the alternative, is because collapse is inevitable. This is from Heinberg 2004. We need to save what we can of nature, non-human and human, but even if we do nothing to decry the overarching system that entails these abuses, the system will disintegrate on its own and soon. Opposing is like commuting the sun to set. Thank you.
Can you read the last card for me again?
Sure.
That's okay, I started mine then.
All right, the last card that I had was that the collapse of the current modern industrial system using this technology is inevitable. That means that if you read the entire card, I just gave the main part that was important, that means that it's beneficial to just move towards this small living and small community sustainable approach now, instead of just waiting for these environmental resources to be used and waiting for the system to collapse on its own. It softens the blow if we move towards the system now instead of waiting for it to collapse.
Okay. My only problem with the cards from 95, though, is do they take into account, like, the generation of these renewable energy sources or the production technology that we have now?
Like, yeah, they do. Like, solar energy started being produced in the 80s,
so
and that was a significant
amount.
So the
electrics are now, like, small. Like, they're, like, this big, and they're really a lot cheaper to produce. Like, in Africa, you can get a whole solar generation cell that pumps, like, a car battery for $100, and like the investment keeps going. Like, I don't think this technology was back in 95.
Yeah, there was very, very good solar technology back in 95. Like, once again, it started developing in the 80s. That means that it had over a decade between like 1980 and 1995 to have really good technology.
Okay.
In fact,
okay.
Like,
Okay.
And so like hydropower, wind power, that's all been around since like the late 70s, early 80s.
So I get that, but does it take into account like cleaner fuels like biodiesel, things like that, that have been recent developments that only through like having massive societies we can produce?
I think that you have to look at the mindset of the criticism in general. Like, using this cleaner fuel is still thinking in an anthropocentric way. We're still seeing that we can use the environment to our advantage, and eventually that's going to cause destruction as well.
So I think that at the point when we destroy these societies, like, how do we gather together? Like, how are we going to solve environmental ills, like, if we don't have a federalized system of government, or we don't have, like, large communities? Like, how can we
stop
this?
I'm not saying that we have to move away from government all over. I'm saying that we have to move towards
small
community approach.
Like, I don't see how you still have, the federal government if you have these smaller communities.
All right, cool. I'll just grant that we don't have the federal government. I think that I can outweigh that. But what is your question exactly on that? Like, how do we have better life, or what are you asking?
Systems like Superfund, you know, if we actually gave it money to work, would save, like, would go and clean up, like, environmental sites. Like, I don't understand how you have these smaller communities, how you have the global action, welfare reforms, and, like, other environmental
You won't have the problems that these systems are causing.
But how do you solve the problems that are already existing?
Well, eventually, like...
Eventually, we'll, like, go sleep in, or...
Well, yeah, like, small communities approach can solve those problems, too. Like, you still have it. A lot of infrastructure within
the
small community.
On the other side, on the significant argument, I would like to address the fact. So basically, you're saying that the policy, because it's not actually generating through this specific topicality, like if I beat topicality, do I beat significance? Like if I can show it?
No.
Okay. The T argument, and then going into significance, then go DAs and on base. Okay, so let's first look to the T argument tell you here, right? Like she tells us that produce means to give birth or rise to, but I'd say the counter definition for produce, like from Merriam-Webster itself, for production, is the creation of utility or the making of goods available for use. Like I'd say the federal government is the only one who can make these like goods available for use because they significantly make the markets more competitive. Like I think at that point, you're gonna be looking at my definition like furthermore. But secondly, I'd say look at the word policy.
policy in this resolution. Like, policy from Merriam-Webster is quoted as being a high-level overall plan embracing general goals and acceptable procedures, especially in a governmental body. Like, we have to make sure that the federal government can produce this, and I think that only through actions and policies of the federal government, you can do this. Like, the federal government isn't gonna go, hey, you know, I'm gonna go, like, turn a wind turbine. Like, they have to generate policies that are engaged by state and federal, like, state minimal levels to go ahead and make this happen. So I think in getting into the specific like argumentation that she gives you here on the fee part, like she says that if we do a shift, like if I say that this is good, like that we can still be topical, that it's being a shift in plan, but I'm saying that I'm maintaining the same advocacy through and through. Like, and secondly, she says that this is a violation of ground. Like, I think that it's pretty clear. Like, I think that not only RP has like a pretty predictable case to be running, but I'd say that secondly, like, I think it's set up very clearly, like, what the ground in this debate is. Like, either, like, she gives you the solvency, like, DAs and stuff, like, she gives, like, the significance. Like, I think the ground is pretty well set here. But thirdly, I think this is like a generic definition. Like, you want to prefer mine because not only does it take into account the two contexts of the meeting and you get more of a generalization of what the resolution actually means, but I'm actually upholding both ideas. So let's go, actually, let's touch on case and the solvency first. Because I want to make a couple cross applications. Okay, against the significance that she gives you on the A point in observation one, she says that this is not a significant plan. However, I have three cards telling you how reductions of CO2 emissions through RPS are significant. Firstly, the U.S. has responsibility and interest to reduce CO2 emissions through RPS, Unit of Concerned Scientists 06. With only 5% of the world population, the United States produces nearly 25% of annual global heat trapping emissions. Electricity generation accounts for fully one-third of these emissions. We have a responsibility and a compelling interest to significantly reduce these harmful emissions. Renewable electricity standards offer smart, affordable climate solutions with a proven track record. But I think secondly, you're going to be looking at the fact that a 20% national standard would cut CO2 emissions in half. Unit of Concerned Scientists 06. The 20% national standard would reduce the projected growth of power plant CO2 emissions by more than half, or 434 million metric tons per year by 2020. This will equivalent to taking nearly 65 million cars off the road or planting 104 million acres of trees in an area approximately the size of Oregon and Washington State combined. Even a 10% standard would deliver substantial climate benefits, reducing annual CO2 emissions by 166 million metric tons by 2020. Studies by the U.S. Energy Department of Energy Information Administration have shown similar results. But I would think, thirdly, that when you look to the fact that states need RPS solutions for federal action to expand, you're going to be seeing that why we are significant in this case. Not only reducing CO2 emissions by half, but we need this to happen, that way we can have it on a state and national level. So look at RAB 06. This report illustrates the classic place of federalism in energy and environmental policy. States adopting RPS are providing actual data and real-world models, and the early success of these states are changing the debate about what states can do individually to accomplish their energy systems, how states can compete regionally, and whether federal RPS may be feasible. These states are also, however, pushing up against the limits of what states can do without federal support and coordination. Engagement between these state and policymakers are on the state and surprisingly limited and is overdue. I think the fact that we show you that not only is it significant in like a huge degree, but secondly, only the federal government and this anthropogenic like climate that we live in can solve for the harms, that you're going to be voting for us. Not only on the fact that we reduce CO2 emissions, but that we have an obligation to do so. So let's go ahead and hit the DA before I get back to case. I have one like argument against the entire DA, the progressive reform. Okay, she says progressive reforms are what we need. Through the Heinberger card, that we should choose gradual, that choosing gradual things are bad, and that basically that we need a drastic change to go ahead and stop this. Like, I say that the RPS plan is a drastic change. Like, it is entirely significant, and it's something that the U.S. federal government has to engage in order to stop these anthropogenic, like, CO2 emissions from evolving. But secondly, I'd say that by doing this, like, she gives, like, the C and D cards, but particularly say that technology is bad and that we can't do this and we're not taking the environment seriously. Like, I say the development of RPS, especially looking that we don't build wind turbines in areas where, like, birds migrate, show that we are taking, like, serious account of the environment. Like, if these plans aren't going to, like, evolve if we don't have federal support from them or state support from them, they're not going to want to destroy their communities. Like, I say plan solves. But secondly, I would say that, like, through the criticism, you're never going to get these progressive reforms. Like, not on the big level that she wants to give you. Like, I say the significance is diminished on her side when she can provide for a better way to solve for these harms. Which she grants me by, well, we'll get into that. Okay, so on the small communities. Cross-apply my analysis where I tell you that only, like, the RPS can solve for cutting the CO2 emissions in half. Even if we move to the smaller communities, however, my second argumentation would be that we can't clean up stuff if we have these smaller communities. Like, the federal government and the federalized system and this huge coalition and not only people but resources is the only way to stop these problems which are created. I think you're going to go with the affirmative advocacy because I'm the only one who can solve problems here. But on the case. Okay, on observation two harm, she said it's bad to assume that all this money becomes terrorism, but I say that just because it's bad doesn't mean it's untrue. She doesn't give me analysis as to why this is happening. She says that OPEC is not the biggest producer, but I'd say that we're still funding it if we send it money overall, unless she has in fact this card. But I say, when we see that Alexander says that we risk extinction, and when I solved the significance thing, you're not only seeing that we stopped funding terrorist regimes, but also that we solved for anthropogenic CO2 emissions, which cause not only negative health effects, but climate change and stuff like that. Like, look at my my C card under solvency, where we go ahead and tell you from the University of Scientists that like we solve for fuel diversity, energy security, and economic goals. Like, this strengthens the U.S. economy, it makes it better, and it also saves kids from, you know, developing like asthma and stuff like that. Like, I think like the overall idea here and what you're doing is that the federal government is the only way to solve.
Can I
address
my
project?
Yep.
How much
time?
2 minutes
remaining.
And then I'll go to the topicality and the criticism. I think one of the main reasons that you're going to be voting for me today is because she didn't respond to one of the significance arguments. She didn't respond to the first significance argument that I made about how 40% of the states already are using this. That means that her plan isn't significant. And since significance is a stock issue in NFA-LD, that means if she's not significant, you have to vote her down. I'm sorry. But so Floetta Cross, she didn't respond to it. She can't respond to it now. Next, she reads a bunch of cards about how all this significantly decreases CO2. But I have a couple responses to this. The first response that I have to this is that that's not a significant increase in production, which is what the topic asks her to do. But the next response that I have is that, like, if this was true, then you already would have seen this decrease, like, with the states that already have it. If RPS actually decreased the amount of CO2, then she would have had cards, like, showing you about how, like, it decreased it for these states significantly as well. But furthermore, her advantages aren't about CO2 emissions. All of her harms are about terrorism and oil dependency, and she never demonstrates how she significantly decreases the dependence that we have on oil. Furthermore, I would argue that she doesn't decrease the dependence on oil because you haven't seen that decrease on oil in the status quo with these states that have this standard. That means that the standard itself doesn't cause a decrease in the reliance on foreign oil. Next, she didn't really respond to the fact that the primary concern should be about the environment when we need to not be anthropocentric. This was an overview on her harms, Floetta Cross. She says that only the government can solve for these harms, but this isn't true. That's an anthropocentric view. We need to stop operating in this mindset, move towards small communities, because in a small community, you actually respect where you're living. Look at the whole slogan of not in my backyard. Those are small communities that have started operating together to decrease the pollution and decrease the harms that they see in society today. I would say that that's a very micro example of a where people are moving towards a small community approach, and that's working. But furthermore, I think that if you look towards indigenous peoples, they have way more respect for the environment, and that's specifically what my cards say. So saying that the only way to solve for the harms that we see in today's world just isn't true. I'll talk about this more in the criticism though. Next, on the oil terrorism argument, she says that it doesn't mean it's untrue, and she thinks that any funding, any amount of money that we give to them is still bad. The first response I have to this is that she doesn't solve for oil dependency. She never reads you any cards about how RPS significantly decreases the amount of oil. Just cross-apply what I said on top of this. But furthermore, it does mean it's untrue. I gave you an example of Venezuela specifically and how they're increasing oil production. Furthermore, even if you buy that this is going, the 20% is going to happen by 2020, it's still a lot of money that are going to go to the oil industries. So she kind of turned herself on this. On the plan, she didn't respond to the significance art. Well, she kind of responded with the CO2 stuff, so you can cross-apply what I said to that. Next, on the solvency argument about how I read, she says that the market is driven policy to help sustain markets. That proves the topicality. It's not producing any new energy. Next, on subpoint C, she says that this is solving for fuel diversity, but that allows her to solve for this oil dependency. But once again, it's not significant enough because you would have already seen a significant reduction in the amount of dependency that we have as a nation when you have 40% of our states with the standard. But however, you just see an increase in the oil dependency that we've had. So therefore, that's not going to happen. Plus, if she... Oh, yeah. Okay, cool. Let's just make sure I got everything there. We'll talk about topicality now. All right, she gave you an alternate definition of produce from the same source. She says it's the creation of utility and making goods available for use. The first point I have on this is that these are two counter definitions, and she only meets one of them. So now we have three definitions in the round. She doesn't meet two of them. But furthermore, the only one that she would meet was making goods available for use. But I think that you're going to look at how this resolution is phrased and the resolution in context in itself. Produce is increasing the production, which is how something's made, so the making of this energy. I give you specific analysis of what decides I could have run at the point that she doesn't increase the production of this geothermal or wind power or any of these things. That means that she still violates this topicality. Next, she says that since it's a policy, it's general goals through the federal government. Yeah, you can still have you can still use the federal government and have policy. They'd just be giving money to increase the production of energy. They'd give money to have some sort of implementation for geothermal or wind power. They do a grant for plants. That's an example of a topical plan. That means that my standards really flow through. On the ground, she says that this is a predictable topic. That doesn't mean that it's topical. Even though RPS is an energy policy, it doesn't mean it's increasing the production of source energy from renewable sources. And the next point, she says that the ground is clear and on significance and that is a generic definition, but that's not really responsive to my ground standard here about the dissents that I lost ground to run. So therefore, you are going to be able to vote on topicality. But we'll move on to the criticism. The main issue on this is that she says that you can't clean stuff up if you move towards a small community approach. I have a couple responses. The first one is that our attempts to solve these problems in the modern industrial system just creates the problems once again. Look at an example of cleaning up waste where we just transport it instead, and that has resulted in a lot of harm. You have the truck that does it, and also you have spills of the waste. But furthermore, the environment has cycles, and the environment will naturally repair itself, but we have to stop messing with it if we ever want it to be able to repair itself. For that reason, you're going to prefer the alternative. She says that the criticism isn't significant, but significance isn't my burden, and I am way more significant because I move away from this system. Next, she says they're taking it serious, the environment in serious account, but they aren't. Just cross-apply what I said on Case. And she says RPS is drastic. It's not 40% of the states have already done it. So at the point that the alternative is net beneficial, you're going to vote on that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Let's go T and on case. I'm usually in for only 3 minutes, so make my time real fast. Okay, I'm going to start on T. I think that when we tell you that looking at production and policy, like I give you this analysis of how the government doesn't go out there and generate energy, like generate the production of energy from renewable sources. Instead, they pass plans, they pass policies which are implemented by other actors to increase the production. So let's look back to plan text, right? Like I tell you specifically that the U.S. federal government is going to mandate that we all have an RPS of 2025 2020. And an RPS, looking specifically at the Peter Sicko 6 card, which I think effectively answers all this, requires a percentage of electricity to be derived from renewable sources, such as wind, solar, biomass, or geothermal energy. We are using these renewable energy profits. Like, I think that when you look at the topicality here, you're seeing that the government doesn't go out there and produce energy. And at that point, we are completely topical, but I want to go back on case and look at the significance here. Like, we tell you, I tell you, too much parley for me, I tell you that, like, by looking at this plan, you're not only, like, increasing the renewable energy that are being used because you're making 60% of the U.S. use this standard, but also that you're making sure that these renewable energies have a sustained market, and that is what leads us into, like, continuation or growth and stuff like that. Like, I'm telling you, like, by looking at this, like, reducing, like, the CO2 emissions, it is not only more beneficial for people, but also by diversifying the markets and stuff like that, that's where we get this explanation of terms. Like, I think that she hasn't gone against the significance argument. Like, when I tell you that only the federal government can solve for these harms and stop, like, and prevent, like, the anthropogenic, like, or fix, like, the anthropogenic, like, stuff that's been happening, and that the smaller communities can't ever do this, like, just say, like, oh, well, you know, it'll, like, repair itself. Like, I say that by looking at the federal government as an actor here on plan, you're seeing that we solve for specific things. And specifically looking at the Peter 606 card that I give you in case, and then secondly, at the C card, the Scientific American card, like, when we go ahead and tell you that this increases, like, renewable energy markets, but also it reduces CO2 emissions and makes the energy markets more diverse, we're having a significant impact here. But I'd say, look at the fact that on the criticism, I tell you that, you know, they can't solve for anything. Like, the government is the only way to solve not only cleanup, but also, like, maintenance, like, maintenance of, like, through mass resources and policy actions for the environment, like, the betterment of all people. Like, what she says, we have to move away from, like, this mindset and the energy, like, the environment will fix itself. Like, I say that's not a good thing that we want to use. Like, when we're, like, what I'm telling you here is that only the federal government, only through huge, massive policy actions can we stop and prevent and fix what we've already done. Like, okay, maybe we do some stuff bad sometimes, but we have to look at overall, it's better for the welfare of the people to not only have these, like, communities, like, or this small, the big federal government, but secondly, to do the RPS. We're doing this, we're reducing the CO2 emissions by half. We're diversifying the renewable energy markets, which makes them cheaper and more affordable to use. Like, that's how we get the energy diversity. Like, she's missed the cards here. Like, she's in climate analysis. But I think that when you look at this overall, you're seeing that only through the federal government and the specific action and policy that I give you can you solve the environmental and ecological harms.